struggle against the poverty.
It's good without the sound also. You can look at it. So yeah, this video is about many other things other than maybe how a single parent brings up a child. and I believe some of the message has been conveyed to you. And technically, when we talk of print versus digital or digital versus print or what works, it is basically what brings happiness. And as he spoke about being the chief enjoyment officer, right? So that is, I think, the problem. Or not, I would not say problem. This is our society today. Let's face it. This is how we work. This is how we lead our life. And sometime maybe we leave behind the learner. And that's what we need to work around. And that's what we need to solve. So we have a lot of statistics which show that India is growing in terms of print business. India is the second largest publisher of English material around the globe. India is the largest publisher of digital content outside of US. So it's growing in every aspect. So it's, nothing is getting left behind. But that doesn't give an indication. How does it work out? In a country where we have 1.4 million schools and 227 million learners, do you think that one size would fit all? Maybe even we saw in some countries, we spoke, saw about UK, where you have different standards for such a small population. But in India, can we derive a single system to fit all the people, all the students across the country? Somebody did speak about a village school versus a posh school in Delhi. So, coming back to the favorite subject, what worked in India? What was so great about India? And what's our heritage? Our heritage is the Gurukul system. The Gurukul system where learning was passed on generation after generation from the gurus to the disciples. And we know to what extent the disciples went up to get the education from the gurus, not just in terms of kind of negotiating on tuition fees, but going to the extent of cutting off a finger. So that's the extent that was the value of the Gurukul system. And if you look in terms of what the Gurukul system gave to us, are just sheer specialists in every domain, sheer when we talk of whether it's skill or knowledge or whichever way you talk of, they were the experts in their domains. That's what has been the output. Or when we talk in terms of, we did speak about outcome-based learning system. That's the outcome. That's the outcome the Gurukul system had generated. And we still read about them and get inspiration from that system. Coming to what we do today. What we do today is very interesting. Today, a teacher has 150-odd periods to complete in a year, out of which there are 40-odd in which she has to give up for Earth Day, for Mother's Day, for a Teacher's Day, for a Children's Day, all kinds of activities, some of which are there in the circulars given by the various boards, and some which the school tries to, takes up to initiate, which is very important. They are a part of the school's scholastic activities also, which we cannot do without them. But of course, that leaves the teacher that amount of lesser time, because the curriculum, mind you, was planned for those 150 periods that you get in a year. After that, half the year you have various kind of examinations you conduct. So you have lesson planning. Your lesson plan is mostly history. So you go by year after year, you go through the lesson plans that you have been delivering. And in case the classes get changed in a year, it is slightly traumatic because you have to rework the whole thing again. And that's what I see my wife doing very frequently. So that's, they start off with a lesson plan, get to the classes, doing the same questions over and over again, giving the same assignments again each year after year. Most painful is correcting those answer sheets. So there are some, with the periodic tests coming in, there would be some changes in the evaluation system. But with the FA and SA, we had 6 exams roughly, which you had to assess students and give marks on. So those examination papers had to be corrected. And then the most troublesome activity was to add up the marks. So that used to take a couple of nights, then collate them and put them onto the computer so the grade sheet could be generated. And then the grades are given, there is a PTM, there is some discussion on the student learning outcomes. And again, the class continues. And that's what, and what is a PTM outcome like? I think there are mostly about children who are not doing well, how they can be brought up. And I would expect sometimes we also face situations, parents are not coming to schools during the PTMs. Very often, I think, very often. Mostly for the children whom we want their parents to be there, they are not there. So these are typical situations we face in this learning system. And the learning goes on and on and on. That's basically been our story so far. Whether we use print or whether we use digital, it's just the same. Coming off, so who suffers? As we saw in this short video, the sufferer is ultimately the student. Because our learning system, ecosystem, does not give us time to work on the learner. So we spoke of various modes of education delivery. We said you have a tablet, you have a video, you have an animation. It's like you have Complan, Boost, and so many other things of kind of boosters for you. And we will just put it in the milk and give it to you every morning, and we expect that you will grow 2 inches every day. Right? That is what we expect. Right? So, and I don't think that works. And when it doesn't work, what it leads to? It leads to the frustration we saw on the parent, and it leads to the, and who is the victim? Of course, the student. Right, and the whole ecosystem. See, again, I think the ecosystem just goes on and on. Right, each year after year, it's the same story. Print versus digital, again, the debate continues, and there is no end to it. But I think globally what we are seeing that the growth of digital is plateauing. We are not seeing, so when we spoke about 10 years back in the West, digital was the thing to do, and it was the craze, and everybody was running after digital. But gradually we are seeing that the trend in digital is plateauing and it kind of reaching, because it seems the consumers of digital are very fragmented. There are certain portions of the learning community that completely absorbs and soaks it like a sponge. And there is another segment which maybe is not yet ready for it, or there has to be some way we have to prepare them for it before we give them that dose of digital content. So what works, what we feel is a solution to the system? I think the most important thing, or the way it works, is something that works hand in hand. something that works hand in hand, something that complements one with the other, and something that leads to enjoyment in learning, something that leads to knowledge transfer rather than delivery of content. When we talk of digital, we know there is enough of digital experience already available with the children that we are talking of. They are far more expert in handling digital gadgets than we are. So there is no doubt whether they would have the ability to handle digital content, and there is enough of statistics around that. So if we talk in terms of what would be the format that we would kind of, we are working or we would kind of suggest. See, most importantly, I think digital is necessity, is a necessity. And we, the reason because digital is necessity is because of, it's a huge paradigm that we use things like big data, Hadoop, to do business analytics and find out how the companies, rich companies can become richer. We don't use big data and Hadoop for the 227 million students of India, do we? Why don't we do that? Why don't we use the analytics to find out the learning styles of every child and club them into maybe groups and then deliver content according to the differentiated learning needs, rather than trying to give one size fit all and saying that I have a mechanism which is researched in America or US or UK or Finland or whatsoever, and there it works, so therefore we should adopt it. I think the whole issue with the system is, or issue with the system, or maybe it's not an issue, I would say, it is something that we can do better, is use all the technology we have, and I think we are the cauldron of technology. We are the hub of technology globally, and we can use all this technology to find out and do this and use the analytics to find out what suits, what are the various learning outcome, learning styles of different students, and what we should do to enhance the learning outcomes. So in our methodology, it's print books as usual, it remains, because I think that's something that's indispensable, and I think for the next 10-15 years, it's maybe difficult to imagine a world without books. There has to be digital content for enrichment, because what happens is, as I talk, I don't know what amount of span of attention I have been able to grab. With children, it is even more difficult. With younger kids, maybe this is how you can kind of get them engaged and engrossed on content. So therefore, when we talk about digital content, we feel it shouldn't be an overdose of it. But if there is a difficult concept, which visualizing, which may be difficult. So for example, the universe, if I'm talking of the Milky Way, I may show them a video or an animation to give them that imagination. At the same time, when we are talking in terms of homeworks and assessments, these are things we should put completely on the technology as far as possible, because what happens, certain kind of questions, and we have moved a lot to a MCQ based or single word or single sentence based questions. If you have moved to that, that's all can be corrected by technology, whereas the long questions can't be, but the smaller questions can be. So technology can save a lot of time of the teacher, which can be productively used in terms of training herself or even employing differentiated learning processes for different learning needs. And use the outcomes of these assessments. Use analytics there. Use the algorithms there. And all our programming skills there to find out what are the learning needs of a typical child in an Indian scenario. It may differ from, and I'm saying it may differ from a village to a school in Delhi, or it may not. You might find one child, yeah. Can I take it after I finish? Yeah. Okay. So you may find one child in a school in Jhumri Talaiya might have a same learning need as a child in DPS Arkepura. So it's all up to, we don't know that. And we still say that this is a village school and this is a school in Delhi. Right. So, and then we have to cull out those learning outcomes to create differentiated learning processes, and most interestingly, feed it onto the teachers so that the Gurukul system can be revived in some way or the other. We have to feed it onto the teachers so that they are now trained to cater to differentiated learning needs, rather than making a school a factory for mass production of board certificates. So that's all. And when I said the Gurukul system, the last thing in fact I had to say was, let us, we speak so much about remedial and work on the weaker child. Why don't we say that every child has a strength? Let us work on that strength. And that's why, can you imagine Arjuna with a gada or with a Bhim with a bow and arrow? I searched the net yesterday whole night. I couldn't find a single picture. All that I got was this. And that's all. Thank you. You have a question?
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Thank you for the opportunity. My background is IT. I've been a co-founder of about five multi-startups. And one of the companies you might know today as Yahoo Search, it was called Blue Lithium when we started it. When I came to India after being in Spain for 3 years, the first thing we did see was that 95% of our schools do not have the basic e-learning platform. So last year, we started a program called Students.Guru. It is an absolutely free setup hosted on the cloud, courtesy Rama University. So all the school children, the college students, they learn and they also teach and they also learn how to conduct web-based education. Sir, everything you said was exactly what we are trying to do. We already have 110 schools on the system now. The biggest challenge for us has been connectivity across the rural and the semi-rural domain. For that, we've even gone to various government organizations. We've even gone to Nepal and Bhutan. Again, similar issues. Bhutan has got all the IT systems, connectivity, but they are very slow in moving forward. Sir, I would invite Oxford University Press and senior people like yourself to help us spread it. It is absolutely free. In fact, we are now in version 2 of the system. We are developing it because the first time when we got it from school time, the cost was 3 lakh rupees per school per year, which we brought it down to zero. But then the quality of the system was not what the schools expected us. Now we are bringing it up to the level of CBSE. So the basic attendance management framework, the fee management, the transport, logistics, class management, subject management, assignments is already online. It is available. It's also free of cost. So we started this last year, sir. And exactly what you said is what we need. Our basic intent was that once we start getting the data on our database servers, we will be able to identify the top 5% and the top 10% and help them through. One of the key reasons personal to me I did that was because my father runs a foundation which I now support. We have 149 kids, very similarly identified through legwork, and they go through. To your point again, sir, at the Rama campus in Kanpur, there is this Super 30 which was there in Bihar. So you have a Super 100 which is sponsored by GAIL, but we've given them the place to stay and all the facilities and power free. Their education is paid for by GAIL. Food and everything paid for by GAIL. 96 out of 100 of the students have this year cleared the IIT JEE mains out of 100. So yes, we are willing to do that, sir. And thank you for your points. And yes, obviously from my response, you can see that though I came in late, but I was listening to everything you were saying. So the span of attention was definitely there, sir.
Great. Thank you. Thanks. I think. I think connectivity has some of the challenges that are around at this place, and but with the Digital India kind of a thought that our Honorable Prime Minister is leading. And now everything more or less moving on to an app-based kind of a scenario, and that's what we are working on, and we are finding. So we have also kind of rolled out a few apps on the pilot mode and seen experimenting with the usage. I think from a PC-based system to an app-based system, we are finding the proliferation being much better. I think the edtech companies are also would be doing that, and they would have also seen some of the advantages of that. Yes, sir.
There was a wonderful presentation. There are a lot of insights and revelations in the presentation that you made. But I just have one question to know, because I've been with this policy making in my Telangana state of plus two level of education.
Right.
You are talking about a very revolutionary method of integrating both the textbook and the digital content. Have there been any studies? Has it been impact? Has it impacted its learning enhancement of performance? Has it been translated into marks? Have been translated into grades? Have there been any such thing? Do you recommend that for the what level of the education, stage of the education? Could it be for middle schools, or is it for higher school, or is it plus two secondary grade? I just would like to know.
Okay. So, in terms of the impact, see, first thing, the whole presentation was about, if you look in terms of measuring of impact first, and then designing what works well. If you see, that's where, and I think technology plays a major role in measuring of impact, rather than saying that these are the four videos, if you see, you will become demigod. Right? I think that's the whole fallacy of the system, and we try to, as I said, Complan Boost and all the kind of energy drinks, the kind of pushed onto a child. Saying that, however, what happens is that, as you rightly said, there are certain age groups where we see the span of attention varying over kind of ages. So if you look in terms of typically a pre-primary and a primary kind of an age, people are now, students are now so much exposed to different kind of media. The students, I think, and the children in that age group, I think every time they are kind of onto the Cartoon Network or things like Shinchan and Chota Bheem are more popular than anything else. So that, given that kind of a concept of learning, we have seen, and it is proven, and it's been there for quite some time, it does kind of increase the span of attention and help a child absorb a concept that is otherwise difficult to absorb. One of the things, if you look in, I'm not getting into any statistics and proven data. One of the things that you would usually see is that up to class 5, anything shown in class, if it is an animation or a video, it basically helps a retention better, because it's something he is able to recall when he is looking onto the printed book. So, for example, when I say that about the galaxy, if I am talking of the Milky Way and the planets in the Milky Way, when I read the book, it is very difficult to imagine what is the Milky Way. But when I have a video backup, it may be it's easier. Similarly, if you go to a class 6 to 8 child, they do something in the class. What happens when they go home? Most of the children today have access to some digital device or the other, or many have, I would not say many, most, many have. The children who are privileged to have it, let me put it this way. If they get somewhere stuck, they immediately go on to Google and search it out. And they usually try to look in terms of some YouTube video or other. So I am not talking in terms of some statistics based on this thing, and there are enough of statistics again, sir. But let us see in terms of learners' need. Rather than saying that I have so many studies done by UK or US or this scientist or that scientist, let us simply, I would suggest and request that let us look in terms of an Indian scenario and an Indian child and what he is doing, whether a teacher and an Indian child. And sometimes we forget the teacher. I think the most important thing, if I fall back on the Gurukul system, is actually empowering the teacher and ensuring the teacher has got enough of tools to make her education delivery absorbing, and kind of ultimately transfer of knowledge. As I said, but the whole system depends on how you are able to evaluate and assess and create your lesson plans according to differentiated learning needs. Because a differentiated lesson plan would actually enhance the outcomes, because then you have catered to the learning need of a different child.
My question is, does it promote outcome-based learning?
Of course.
Does it promote or just enhance? Which one is it?
This is directly about outcomes, and when we say, so for example, there are outcomes or two types. Let me, since you went to a topic of outcomes, let us talk in terms of outcomes a little bit more in detail. So there are two children in class 2, right? Both of them have scored a 10 on maybe 15 maths. One of them might have got all the questions wrong on calculations, whereas her approach on the concept was right. The other one might have got two easier questions right and has left or has not been able to attempt the 5 difficult ones. As you go up, both the children are rated in the class, but both of you are poor in maths. As you have got a 20% marks, both of you are poor in maths. As the child progresses in the life, he is always branded poor in maths. So what happens, but if you had actually had a differentiated learning outcome, by the 5th grade, the child who was doing well in the concept could actually improve on calculations only by rigor and practice. But because he was branded that you are poor in maths, he started hitting maths from class 1 itself. Similarly, other child who is weak in maths is now forced to do maths because you are weak in maths. And because concepts kind of doesn't work with her, she doesn't get differentiated learning. She's struggling, but she'll never do. So ultimately, as I said, end of the day, what is important is outcomes. Everything has to be outcome driven. Because as you saw in the video, there the outcome was that piece of paper. It depends on what you call as outcome. For me, the outcome was the piece of paper where he was supposed to write ABCD. And every time he was doing a different kind of an ABCD, which he thought was his ABCD. So outcomes means I would stress the whole fact of the whole component of digitization or technology enablement is first to measure outcomes and then change your learning methodologies to meet differentiated learning outcomes so that you can get outcomes as per the need of the child rather than what we want. Right.
Are you trying to propose that this is going to be a futuristic technology?
This technology is already there in India. So
it is going to be the future.
Yeah, this is going to be the future because the whole global system is all about outcome based. There is nothing that is so. We did talk about a lot of we know that India is about philosophy. But I think we have come out of the age of philosophy to get into the age of data now. So therefore, everything has to be outcome driven. And anything that you do, first, everything has to have enough of data to draw inferences. And from those inferences, you have to kind of cater to that need.
Thank you very much.
Any further questions? Any further questions from the house? I think it was a lovely session where the entire spectrum of education technology was expanded. I would request the Honorable Chairperson, Mr. Arkevesh, to do the honors on Sanjoy Majumder, sir, who has summed it up in such a fabulous fashion, the print and the digital, the synthesis, which is probably we are trying, we are seeing it across themes since morning.
Thank you so much, Arav, and thank you for inviting me to this.
We have a very interesting video from my class board. We will use the Jawad approach all over again to play it in the backdrop. So, yeah. So request the camera persons to play the